wanted to ask if anyone has any job openings or announcements, like sort of pertinent event announcements. We want to keep them really short. So we've got a lot of material to go through today, but if somebody has job postings, job postings, do that. And I think Matt's going to run on one side and Seth is going to run through the other.
Hi, I'm Tom Bush from the State of Oregon, and we're going to be at Mobile World Congress in Barcelona, Spain, February. We're going to have a small booth, 3x3 meters. If anyone's going there to walk the show, please do Oregon companies. Feel free to use it as a hangout place to meet. And we may have a little bit of money for per diem for companies that qualify too. Just contact me, Tom Bush.
It's a great opportunity if anyone is going to take your business to Mobile World Congress. It might make sense for you. Mobile World Congress is a great place. Barcelona every year. Lots of mobile technology there. Another thing, when you speak, hold the mic to your mouth and so things up a little bit better. There was somebody back in the back.
Hi, my name is Dale Appel, and I'm with Dark Horse Comics. We have a small development staff maintaining our mobile applications for iOS and Android, and we are hiring. So if you're interested, please come see me. Or look at our website at darkhorse.com. Thank you.
So, as I mentioned, I wanted to thank our sponsors, and I'm going to give them a couple minutes each to talk a little bit about what they do. And so first I wanted Garrett to come up and talk about Ziva, and also tell us about these chairs, which he doesn't know that I'm going to put him on the spot about, but I really want to everybody to understand how cool these chairs are. So, here's Garrett.
Welcome to Ziva, everybody. Jason asked how many people have been to Mobile Portland before, but I'd also like to ask how many people have been to Ziva before. Show of hands, nice. Yeah, we definitely try to open this space up to the community. We host events like Creative Mornings here, Portland Seed Fund events, and now I'm super excited to have Mobile Portland here. I've been to probably at least a half a dozen Mobile Portland events over the last year or two, so when Jason approached me to host it here, I was pushing for that. So a little about Ziva, I guess I can start with the chairs. We're a strategic design and innovation consultancy, so what does that mean? We solve complex problems. So our first problem we solved when we moved in here was we initially had poured this concrete to essentially sit directly on the concrete. So imagine sitting there without a chair behind you. And so, but getting some feedback, people wanted chairs to sit in, so but we already had poured the concrete, so as you'll notice, the legroom there isn't big enough to accommodate a typical standing chair. So we designed this chair in the house called the jump seat. We've got a patent on it. I want to begin to explain the... I won't do the... that's better. That's much better. Yeah, I don't think I'll do the intellectual property justice, but essentially these seats are engineered and they've been extremely popular. So we actually just signed a licensing agreement, and we're going to be distributing them to universities and auditoriums and whatnot. But I'm sorry, I can't go into greater detail around the There's a steel plate and there's all sorts of moving parts, but it actually is a pretty phenomenal chair. So, but quick background on Ziva. Ziva's been around for 28 years. The founder, Sora Vasugi, his background is in industrial design and product development. So Ziva's heritage is definitely rooted in industrial design, mechanical engineering, product design and development. But over the last three decades or so, we've kind of expanded in response to market trends, but also in response to client needs to kind of offer a fully integrated design offering. So we do everything from, obviously, we still do a lot of industrial design projects and mechanical engineering. We've got a fairly robust internal consumer insights and trends group. We go out and do a lot of design research, user testing, things like that. We also have a communication design group that focuses on everything from packaging design, out-of-box experience, graphic design, copywriting, messaging strategy, things of that nature. We also have user experience design, and I think that's probably most appropriate for tonight's audience. Our user experience group, there's several members in the audience here. I see a fist pump up in the background, so we've got a handful of our designers here. Art designers are definitely broken out into three different groups. We have interaction designers, visual designers, and what we call kinetic designers. We do a lot of prototyping, we do a lot of visual design, we do a lot of interaction design. Interesting thing about Zeba's design group, our UX group, is we don't do just mobile apps. We also do everything from embedded interfaces on a boombox, an equalizer on a boombox. So we do things like interactive retail walls. We also do mobile app development, things like that. So our user experience design group is super talented. I'm glad they all can be here. And then aside from that, we also have a strong retail design group and what we call service design. So all of that, we're really focusing on the integrated experience end-to-end. So that's Zeba. Glad to have you all here. Special thanks to Aaron for coming down and speak to us. So thanks. Oh, and yeah. I also want to mention the Wi-Fi password as well is authenticity. It's a big word here at Zeba. Authenticity with a capital A. And then if you're posting things on Twitter and Instagram, et cetera, Zeba's handle is at ZebaPDX. So thanks.
Garrett actually forgot one thing, which is that Zeba is hiring, which I think you were supposed to make a pitch for, right? Yes.
I'm going to get in trouble for that. We're always looking for great talent, and our designers here come from a wide variety of backgrounds, cultural anthropology, social sciences, all sorts of different backgrounds. So if you're interested, I'll be in the back. Come chat with me.
Thanks, Garrett. We also have Metro Mile, before I forget, Carrie, I mentioned earlier that if you have not participated in the raffle, that you can enter the raffle, and Carrie's got the information down here. $250 for bike gallery. So Metro Mile is really cool. It's a startup starting up related to insurance. If you drive less, you get reduced rates. But I'll let Steve talk a little bit more about that, but the thing that I'm really interested in is apparently, there's some way that it connects to your phone, which makes it wholly appropriate for this audience. So, Steve, you want to come up and talk a little bit about Mr. Mine?
Okay. Well, thank you. This is a great opportunity for us. And if you've never heard of MetroMile before, that's because this is our first time actually talking publicly about what we're doing. So I just wanted to start out maybe with a...
There we go.
Start out with a couple numbers just to kind of frame the problem and the issues that we are working to address. 22, that's actually the number of hours per day that the average car is idle. Most of the statistics I've seen actually say that people drive their car about 45 to 90 minutes a day. So your car is sitting there doing nothing for about 95% of the time. Second number, 3,000, that's actually the reduction in the number of annual miles driven by people under 40 in the U.S. over the last 10 years. So about 10 years ago, people under 40 were driving about 11,000 miles per year. Today, it's more around 8,000 miles per year. And that's being driven by a number of different things. Gas prices is obviously affecting it, but a lot of it is more lifestyle based. So people are making more responsible decisions. We're looking to live in more concentrated communities. We are trying to make more use of public transportation, bike commuting, walking to do the things that we need to do. And so we started really with the premise that the people that are making these trade-offs that benefit all of us, they help improve the livability of our cities, and they help reduce the environmental impact that we have, aren't being rewarded adequately. And one of the major culprits in that, the traditional businesses that aren't keeping up with that, is auto insurance. So, you came to a mobile meetup and some guys up here talking to you about auto insurance. But what we are really looking to do is charge people on a per mile basis for what they drive. So if someone, you drive a few miles, you get charged for that. If you decide to take the max to work or bike commute or walk, you're not getting charged for that at that point in time. We think that's a fairer way to do auto insurance. We think it rewards people for the smart choices that they are making, and we're looking to encourage that. So the way we do it is we put a device in the car, and actually every car that's been made in the US since 1996 has a standard port. We actually use that primarily as a power source. I talked to Garrett, we call it the metronome. We embrace its ugliness at this point, but I was talking to Garrett earlier that we could potentially use some of their industrial design help at some point as we move along. But essentially, you plug it into the car. It's got a GPS unit in it that works as an odometer. It's got a cellular modem in it, and so it's sending us the data on per mile, how much you're driving. We're charging you on a per mile basis for it. We don't care, and we're not billing people based on where they drive, when they drive, or how they drive. It is purely, here's a per mile rate, here's the number of miles that you drove, and here's what you would pay for the insurance based off of that. And then we give people a customer experience that is really geared toward helping people understand their driving and what trade-offs they can make to drive even less and save even more. And that's really what our focus is. So I'm going to leave you with one more number. 5.5 billion, that's what the US insurance industry spent last year on advertising in the US. It is largely being driven by the fact that there is no real difference in their products from company to company, and we're here to work to change that. So the reason that we're here today is really to say we're launching, the first place we're doing this is in Portland. This is the market that we're starting. We're going to be looking at starting to write policies next month. And so we're going to communities like this to really start helping get the word out and looking for support as we go and try and change an industry and do something that we think will lead to a longer term societal benefit along the way. And so we're gathering names here today. You can also go to metromile.com and sign up. We've got so we'll let you know the moment that we start writing policies and are launching. And if you have people you know that you think would benefit from this, let them know as well. But thank you very much. That's what we're here for, and we look forward to being active here in the Portland market very soon. Thank you. And the winner of the raffle is that Sean Lally? So, I would really like to thank our sponsors. We would not be in this tremendous facility, wouldn't have the great food that we have if not for the sponsors. So can we please, just one more round of applause for the sponsors? Can we go back to the first deck for just one more, for a couple more slides? Or maybe not? Yes, that one. Thank you. Cool. All right. Briefly, for those who have been following along, we are working on creating a community device testing lab. The lab exists now. It is currently being hosted at Cloud4, our company, but you can fill out a form and come in at any point and test on 40-some-odd devices, and more devices are getting added all the time. So we've got... everything from Android devices to Amazon Kindle devices to Apple, all these different things. So it's a great way to test whatever you're working on. If you see a device that you're looking for, just let us know. If you are interested in BlackBerry devices and you don't see it on the list, also let us know, because we've got connections with RIM and we can order devices in as needed. So that's where we're at right now. We're continuing to work. Brendan's leading a charge to work on sort of a virtual library of devices that community members own that they might be willing to loan other people. And then we've also got devices that people are contributing. I know Intel is, I think, going to be doing some. I don't know if Aaron knows, but I've been badgering Amazon today. It's arriving tomorrow. Awesome. So thank you, Amazon. And we've got some other individuals who are just contributing devices. Eventually, we want to have a physical location that's separate that people can go to and the staff to maintain it. We're starting out small in that regard. So if you are looking to test stuff or if you want to donate devices, please go to mobileportland.com and look up that information.
And with that, I want to get underway. I am so excited to have Aaron here to talk about Amazon and Amazon's App Store. One of the pleasures of organizing and helping organize Mobile Portland is that occasionally you get to pick a topic that you personally want to see happen. And so I think I emailed a bunch of people at Amazon and spammed them until I found the right person, and we absolutely got the right person. So Aaron is, I see alternately director or leader, product leader. I see both titles, I'm not sure which, but basically he is the guy for the App Store, which is what I'm sure that we're all here to talk about, and he's gonna talk a little bit about that. So please join me in giving a warm welcome to Aaron Rubinson.
Good evening. This is a little bit like, can you hear me okay? Am I working? It's a little bit like Mad Max at Thunderdome down here. If anybody starts climbing down the walls and I have to escape, you can just let me know. That'd be great, Steve. Thank you so much for having me up. Excited to give this talk. Thank you, Jason and Garrett, whenever you escape too, and Steve. Great idea. So I'm the director for Amazon's App Store for Android. For the U.S., we've started expanding internationally, as we'll talk about, and we're bringing on some new folks overseas. But when we're talking about Kindle Fire in the U.S. or our client for non-Amazon tablets and phones, the guy. So excited to tell you a little bit about what we do. Just to help get to know the audience a little bit, first of all, how many of you have ordered something from Amazon.com before? Excellent. My work here is done. It's been great talking to you. Great. All right. More seriously, how many of you write code for a living or manage people who write code? Awesome. And how many of you know that you wouldn't have a job without those people whose hands were just in the air? Yes. Excellent. Okay. Good. And we have some designers in the back. User experience designers. Excellent. Good. What? Here gets a shout out. I get no shout out. We've got our team, we've got both business folks and technology folks. The presentation I've got here covers a little bit of both, and I'm going to leave time at the end for questions and we can go wherever you'd like. Let's see here, excellent. Plan for today is give a couple of quick slides talking about Amazon and mobile, our history there. Then I'm just going to start from the beginning about what the actual opportunity is for both Kindle Fire and distribution through Amazon off of Amazon devices. Then we're going to move into a little bit of engagement and monetization, things that are super important for us and for our developers, and tell you a little bit about what we offer and how we're thinking about that. And then towards the end, we're going to move into basically what it takes to get up and running for distribution through Amazon and the devices, talk about some of the resources we have, and then open it up for questions. So let's jump in. Amazon Mobile. Quick stats on Amazon. So it's great that you're all customers, and again, thank you for that. We have about 180 million active customers worldwide. We define active customers as those who have made a purchase for something, physical or digital, in the last 12 months. And so we have lots and lots, actually many more people have interacted with us at some point, but this is the active pool. Honing in on the U.S. just for a second, that generates about 85 million visits per month on our website, and just shy of 11 million per day. So lots of activity going on as we talk about things you can use when it comes to discovery amidst a massive selection like we have in the apps market segment. The average customer visits us about a little more than once a week, 5.2 times. At the bottom, I don't know if you can read it, if you can. A little bit of demographic information. When it comes to age, we more or less track with the internet at large, although we skew slightly older. A little bit stronger with families with kids in particular, than the general U.S. population and the general internet population. The good news about that, if you pan to the right-hand side, is when it comes to people actually opening their wallets and spending money with us, we do pretty well. So you've got there the percentage of our customer base that has made a purchase less than $50, between $50 and $200, and over $200. And so you can see 28% of our customer base has spent more than $50, and 39% of the customer base has spent more than $200 on something with Amazon. The reason that that's super important from an app's perspective is that obviously monetization is hard work. And we have a large customer base that, number one, is used to buying things from us, whether they be physical goods or increasingly digital goods. Number two, they'll have payment instruments on file with us. So when we're talking about a device like Kindle Fire, the one-click process, which is actually two clicks on a touch device, is pretty simple. And the fact that people think of us as a commerce destination, they trust us as a payment provider, they know we have good service and something goes wrong, that is resulting in really strong conversion and monetization, which is great for all of us. So basic stats about Amazon there. When it comes to mobile, we're going to talk a lot about the Fire family. We're going to talk about our Android client for non-Amazon phones and tablets there. What a lot of people forget is that we are also a pretty significant mobile app developer ourselves. We have had a mobile shopping app for many years. When we launched the Kindle product family, we came out with the Kindle app that allows you to read your Kindle purchases not just on the devices, but on iOS devices and BlackBerry and Android. And then everything else up there is just a smattering, actually, of the apps that we offer. We have subsidiaries, Zappos, IMDb, Amazon Fresh. Those all have apps. Audible is another one, podcast, and you probably use that. We have specialized apps for students, for Amazon Fresh, our Fresh grocery delivery service up in Seattle. We have a lot of apps. So we, number one, understand how hard it is to create a good app. Two, we understand how hard it is to get adequate distribution, marketing, exposure for apps, because we're fighting that same battle. And three, we understand some of what works and what doesn't work when it comes to convincing customers to do something other than open your app, to actually convert. And so we've really tried to bring all of that knowledge to bear in not only the App Store, but the Kindle Fire platform, which is essentially, you know, it's a platform, but it's a large app in and of itself. A little bit of timeline for mobile app distribution at Amazon, and we're going to dive actually much deeper into this as we go. We launched the App Store for Android. That was for non-Amazon phones and tablets back in March of 2011. At that time, there was no Kindle Fire. And fast forward 6 months later, we launched the first generation Kindle Fire in November of last year. Significant accelerator, both in terms of our reach, but also our ability to convert, for reasons we'll talk about shortly. And then this year, we've just had a whole slew of product announcements for both Kindle and for mobile app developers. We went to general availability on our in-app purchasing SDK in April. I'm going to talk a little bit about that. More recently, we launched the first stage of our social engagement layer for games called Game Circle. And so we're going to talk about the APIs we have there and how we think that's super important for driving engagement and monetization. And then more recently, obviously, we launched a new family of Kindle Fire devices in the US. And then also announced that we're starting to expand internationally. So we'll talk a little bit about how our reach is growing as well and some of what that means when we're thinking about mobile app development from our third-party app developers. That's where we've been. Let's talk about distribution. So I'm assuming that everyone has seen the new family of Kindle Fire devices. Two devices on the left are the electronic ink devices. They do have apps of a sort called Kindle Active Content, but that's not Android, that's a different platform. So mainly talking about the devices here on your right. They're the Kindle Fire family. We have the original Kindle Fire first generation, that we sold for $199. We now have three more. So the next iteration of the Kindle Fire, with a standard definition screen, the price has dropped to $159. It has more advanced hardware and a cheaper price. And then we have two high definition versions that are out. There's a 7-inch high def version, which is now at $199. And then the 8.9-inch starts shipping relatively soon on the 20th.
of this month. And that means a Wi-Fi version for $299 and a WAN version for $499. So at this point, sales of the first generation Fire have stopped. And so we're basically talking about these three new devices on a going forward basis. But obviously the installed base for the first generation Kindle Fire is still quite large. So something we think a lot about with our developers. These products, they're doing well for us. The original Kindle Fire was the number one, has basically been the number one best-selling product on Amazon of all of the products that we sell since we launched it back in November. No mean feat, given the popularity, the units we move in a lot of other product categories like books and music and whatnot. Over 10,000 five-star customer reviews. We let customers review our own products totally unfettered, just like any other product, whether it's a digital camera or a movie. And customers really like it, which is great. And in the first 9 months, from a sales perspective, we got about a fifth of the U.S. tablet market when it comes to Android devices. And so excited, given that we're just getting started in this space. Some of the reasons why we think it's been successful, just to make sure we have the same basic information. Number one, when we're talking about high-def devices, the screens are really great. If you haven't seen one, I've got a couple here in my bag, and happy to show you afterwards. They're a fantastic experience. The sound also is really strong. It's kind of the latest Dolby technology, really loud. It's the simple things that matter. We really designed this as an immersive media experience for consumers, with the idea that they'd be engaging with Amazon Instant Video and the Cloud Drive music playing service, and the sound is awesome, which is important for that. It's got fast Wi-Fi. Perhaps the thing that gets talked about the most is the fact that there is this massive content ecosystem. It's up over 22 million pieces of content across all the different categories. The vast majority of that is music, but we're up over 100,000 videos, up over 100,000 audio titles from Audible, our subsidiary. And then there's the App Store as well. App Store, when we launched the store back in 2011, we had about 4,000 apps. We're now up to just shy of 60,000. So some solid progress there. Some of the extras that come with these devices, if you haven't been a Prime member before, you get a free month of Prime. So that's not only free two-day shipping and next-day shipping for $4.99, but there's the over 10,000 movies and TV shows that are free to Prime members. There are other benefits like the Kindle Owners Lending Library, where you can basically check out books for free and check them back in, which is great. And a number of other benefits across the categories. Strong value prop there. Whisper Sync is that technology where if you started reading a Kindle book on one device, you opened it on the Kindle app, let's say on a different device, and you remember where you were and take you right there. We've extended that API to other product categories. So now videos and games and also voice recordings through Audible also sync, which is pretty darn cool. So we'll talk about the games, Whisper Sync for games here in a minute, because that's important. X-ray is kind of a cool technology. Basically allows you to peer the bones of a book or a movie, see where the characters are, when they make an appearance, tap into the IMDb database, to learn more information about each of those characters. Really strong engagement driver, and it's a feature that's been really popular, especially in movies, which is new. And then the WAN product for 4G has a really innovative data plan. It's 250 megs a month for 12 months. You get all of that for $49 one-time fee. So the idea is to basically have customers just forget about the data and be able to pull it through. So that's the basics. In terms of the reach, so I mentioned early on, a couple slides back, that we started expanding internationally. So Kindle Fire is now available in the US, UK, Germany, France, Italy, and Spain. And we've announced that we're coming to Japan soon. Also, our Amazon App Store for Android client for non-Amazon phones and tablets is in the same, is basically following that same footprint. We've also got some preloading deals that have been slowly and quietly rolling out, very exciting. We actually just appeared on our first Verizon device preloaded, and there are more of those where that one came from. So we're trying to make it really easy for customers that don't have a Kindle Fire device to get the App Store as well. Okay, that's the platform. Also, just wanted to sort of to bring to the fore the fact that we have the websites all around the world. And when we think about the distribution opportunity for third-party developers, a huge part of the value that we can provide is this both automated and curated merchandising through Amazon.com. And if you think about it, we have those 80 million visits a month where we are gathering information about people's interests, what they're looking at, what they're buying, and when it comes to the curated merchandising that we can do for our third-party developers, that's where a lot of the value is that we can add. So here's an example of us showing apps on the gateway of Amazon.com. We've got dedicated category page, as we call it, for the App Store. You can navigate to it just like any other category, like books or music or kitchenwares. All the standard navigational elements, some featured merchandising placements. Our free app of the day program features prominently there. Kind of what you'd expect as an Amazon shopper. When it comes to product pages and product information, they're standard, we call them detail pages. We can provide lots of rich information. This is also, get the pointer, this is also where you start to see some of the personalization technology where we take what we know about customers' interests and try and serve up products that are relevant to them based on those interests. This is the customers who bought this, also bought that. Customers who looked at this, ultimately bought that. I would give us maybe a B grade for our sophistication for apps in particular here, something we're focusing a lot on now. You can imagine you're not in the App Store, you're looking at a Nike watch, and you would see some personalized recommendations that say, you know, here are five fitness apps that people have tended to buy after they're looking at this watch. Or you're in our kitchen store and you're looking at pots and pans, and you would expect to see the Epicurious app and then the Recipes app pop up there. And so that's where we're moving, and there's some of that today, but we can do better, and are working on it right now, actually. Rich information online. We do a great job, I think, of merchandising the products in our online store environments. Customer reviews, both online and on mobile. These are incredibly powerful drivers. Once an app has hit critical mass and has a certain number of customer reviews, assuming they're positive, then that really tends to ignite future sales because customers believe other customers more than they believe anybody else, including us. We also have the Test Drive feature online, which is kind of cool, and actually we rolled it out on our non-Amazon devices as well. So Test Drive, for those who don't know, this is a feature that lets customers try apps before buying them in a browser. So basically, if a customer clicks on this Test Drive button, we actually fire up an instance of the app on a server running on Amazon Web Services, an AWS server. And we then built a little emulator here in the browser and can stream the audio and video back and forth. Customers can interact with these apps in real time, just as if they're interacting with their phone. And so we do this on the website and again on our standard Android client for non-Amazon devices. The idea here is when we're thinking about premium apps primarily, apps with higher price points, this is a great way for customers to get a taste of what they might get without actually having to you know, put the money down. But it's timed, and it's got a buy box at the top. So in theory, if customers like what they see, then they will go on to convert and actually complete the sale. So kind of a cool piece of technology there. When it comes to mobile merchandising, here are some screenshots of the new Kindle Fire device. This is actually the 7-inch device. And on the far left, the advertisement for Diner Dash is on the screen that customers get to by clicking shop. So if you've seen a Kindle Fire, it's got tabs across the top. The top left tab is shop, and it takes you to a listing of all the stores on the device. And that's one of the spaces that we can implement curated merchandising in. So very powerful, viewful ads that are right in front of the customers there. Then the center screenshot is our games, which are on our category page. This is our landing page when people drill into the store and look at games. The number of merchandising placements that are curated, we have these called billboards at the top, and these horizontal, we call them shoveler widgets. This is all curated. And then we have the same thing here on the right-hand side. This is basically the apps landing page within our store. We love to work with developers one-on-one. We talk to literally hundreds of developers every single week. We've got a pretty large team whose sole mission in life is to understand what developers have coming from a roadmap perspective, and to plan for integrated and joint marketing programs for new launches, for updates, for promotions, for marketing programs, etc. We're a little different than the other folks in this business because we grew up as a retailer, and we think we understand what it takes to keep customers interested and not have them not only discover, but buy. And so we're trying to bring that same mentality into the app space, and almost everything that you see on these pages is as a result of that. Typically, activities there are associated with, I'm going to move on and come back to that, are associated with things like targeted email. So on the left-hand side, we're sending an email out for Tiny Village and some other games. As you might imagine, this is going to customers that own a Kindle Fire and have brought other games either from TinyCo or that are like the games that we're merchandising here. A little bit more of an extension is this email on the left-hand side, on your right-hand side. That has the Major League Baseball app featured as the hero. But it's kind of hard for you to see. We have a mix of both physical and digital goods here. So we have movies. We have, I can barely read it, these are games. This is apps and games, and these are periodicals. And so that's an example of an email that went to Kindle Fire owners who we know also happen to be baseball enthusiasts based on other things they've looked at or purchased. And so this is the kind of stuff, kind of targeting that we can do when we're working collaboratively with the developer to time an important release. And then we have a fairly big social presence. Very important to get the word out there. You never really know, frankly, when something's going to go viral, but an area where we have a pretty robust presence as well. Okay, so that's kind of the what we have. We've got devices, we have the client for non-Amazon devices, we have a pretty rich set of merchandising capabilities, and our online storefronts, and we love to interact with developers one-on-one to market and merchandise. What exactly have we developed from a platform perspective to make this thing successful for all of us? First thing we're going to talk about is in-app purchasing. Proven to be incredibly powerful. Obviously, it's a well-known trend in the industry to move towards freemium. These are a couple of screenshots of the in-app purchasing flow for the Kindle Fire devices. So the thing to remember here is that when you get your Kindle Fire, take it out of the box, the first thing you do is you log in with your Amazon customer account. From that point forward, we know who you are as a customer. We drop the authenticated token on the device. The customer never has to sign in to make another purchase unless they want to enable some sort of parental controls because they have kids in the house. So when it comes to in-app purchasing, these are apps, but not Amazon apps, obviously third-party apps, like this is Cutthroat Experiments by Zepto Labs. It's still running on the device, we still have that token, so the in-app purchase experience is literally a two-click experience. Customer clicks on this button and says, I want 20-pack of superpowers, up pops the Amazon-controlled in-app purchase window. Customer clicks on 99 cents, it turns green, they click confirm, and that's it, they're done. And we drop them right back inside the app, and the developer can sort of see the entitlement and then move forward from there. As you might imagine, this very, very nearly totally friction-free process is converting extremely well. And at the end of the day, whether you're spending 99 cents, $2, $4, these are really impulse purchases. And the minute that you ask the customer to enter payment information, as you might imagine, conversion basically goes through the floor. And so the whole key is to make sure that customers first know what they're buying, actually intend to buy the thing they want to buy, But then after that point, have it as frictionless as possible so that while they're in the moment and they decide it's worth it, they can kind of make it through and continue with the excitement of playing the game. You don't want this to distract from whatever caused them to want to buy the thing in the first place, which is playing the game. Here's a study that you may have seen. It's a little bit dated at this point, but this is from Flurry earlier in the year. They looked at a basket of best-selling apps that existed on all three of the platforms, on Kindle Fire, on iOS, and on Google Play. And what they found was that on a revenue per user basis back then, for every buck that these apps were making through iOS, they were making 89 cents through the Kindle Fire platform and 23 cents through Google Play. So I wish that the first two bars were reversed, but again, we're still early in this. It just, again, goes to the power of having the payment instruments on file and having that friction-free conversion process. More recently, we've had a couple of developers write case studies. I'm back on TinyCode here with Tiny Village. They launched Tiny Village concurrently on all three platforms. And put out a blog post talking about the revenue per user that they were seeing, and at this point, the game had changed to the point where for every buck they were making per user on iTunes, they were actually making $1.80 on Kindle Fire, and 65 cents on Google Play. So again, super happy with the monetization results that, that we're seeing in the early days of the platform. Another thing that we've really focused on, switching to the developer-facing technology, is making it super easy. The APIs, if you take a look at them, are very basic. We have some rich capabilities, I don't mean to imply otherwise, most developers find that they can get the APIs up and running in a test environment about an hour, typically less. Typical integration is probably an engineer for maybe a week, maybe a week and a half for most of our apps. So this is not heavyweight coding. We've done as much as we can to basically abstract the complexities of the payment processing from you, from the developers, to the point where you just kind of submit your intent and we take care of it from there. Not a barrier when it comes to integrating. I'll share a little bit of data that we've seen about in-app purchasing just to show you how the monetization is occurring. So here we have some data about the assortment of in-app purchasing items and the units sold. Data is a couple months old at this point. The yellow bars are the percentage of the in-app offers that occurred at each of these price points. Cut it off at $10. There are some offers that are higher, but this focused the study on 99 cents to $10. The blue bars are the number of units ordered at each of those price points. And so a couple of interesting things are emerging here. First, as you might expect, there definitely is clustering at 99 cents because that's typically where a lot of the activity has occurred. So you've got a lot of the offers there, and not surprisingly, you also have a fair amount of purchasing there, but it is interesting to note that 99 cents is actually not where the largest concentration of orders is, was. That actually was at 199, and clearly if you add up kind of all the units ordered, most of it is above 99 cents. So again, reiterates the point that even when you're going up to, let's say, $5, maybe even $10, this is not a big purchase for consumers. And so if you've done a good job of bringing the customer into the game, getting them excited about the storyline and the characters, customers are willing to spend a lot more than they would be potentially for in the paid up front model, which is, I think, encouraging. The other thing that's going on here is we have the more sophisticated developers employing a little bit of the good, better, best strategy from a merchandising standpoint. Rather than just having one offer, having a number. You have kind of the cheaper option, you have the premium option, and then there's something in the middle. Not surprisingly, a lot of customers choose the thing in the middle, right? Nobody wants the cheapest package, nobody wants the most expensive package, but developers can use that little bit of marketing psychology to grow the basket effectively, and that's some of what we think we're seeing here. The other thing that we're seeing here is that developers are getting increasingly very sophisticated about which offers they put in front of which customers, segmenting their customer base by activity, by propensity to buy based on past purchases, by progress inside the app or the game, if they have server-side accounts, by activity in other games. And so having a portfolio of in-app offers that they can then target effectively is also leading towards presenting the right customers with maybe slightly richer offers, generating some of these results. So pretty interesting stuff, we think. Here's another chart. This one on the horizontal axis shows the number of in-app offers that were available inside an app or a game. And on the vertical axis, you have the average number of orders per customer in each of those games. And so what you see is a little bit of a trend up into the right line, which basically says that apps with a larger number of in-app offers had higher, had more orders per customer. Same trends that I was talking about before, we think apply here, where if developers have done a good job of having a rich portfolio that allows either customers to graduate into increasing numbers of orders, or to purchase the right order at the right time based on their life stage in the game, that's going to result in more overall orders. There's a little bit of bias here because I think the developers with the larger number of offers tend to be more experienced, and so that may be skewing the data somewhat, but I think that still valuable as a trend for us to be looking at. Here's another interesting piece of data around in-app purchasing. This shows the number of in-app purchases since the hour of the initial download of the parent app, basically the shell that has the in-app offers. And so, not surprisingly, you've got a fair number of customers that are making in-app purchases right away, and then same thing about 24 hours later, but there's a long tail. So 240 hours, we're 10 days out. I'll show you the data on the next slide, but there's a long tail, and so this really speaks to the importance of developing and maintaining a relationship with these customers that goes well beyond the initial download, initial use of the app or the game. Another really interesting thing about this slide, by the way, is that customers are very regular in terms of when in the day they're actually using their devices and making their purchases. And you can see it's almost it's metronomic there, which is very interesting. So some lessons learned from an in-app purchasing perspective. The first day is definitely important. 16% of the value occurs on that first day. About half of the repeat purchases occur within that first hour. So very important not only to get the customer to open the app, but then to keep them in the app long enough to make maybe one, but two, not just one, but two or more purchases. But the key bullet to highlight is this one. 44% of the revenue with these in-app purchase-enabled apps actually occurs after day 30 from that initial download. And so you can imagine that to take advantage of that long-lived purchasing power, there needs to be an effective strategy for surfacing new content, bringing developers back into the game, reaching out to them, whether it's notifications or email or whatever strategy you employ, to get people back in. Because they are willing to continue to spend if they have a reason to come back in. Last little bullet point is interesting. There definitely are whales out there, customers that generate a ton of the revenue, and the most sophisticated developers have very specific strategies for those customers. You need to know how to identify them and how to provide them with the right types of products that are going to make it very easy for them to interact with the app or the game in the way they want. And if you do that, you'll be rewarded. Okay, so that's a little bit about in-app purchasing, one of the major ways that we're seeing engagement and monetization happen. Now I'm going to talk a little bit about Game Circle. Game Circle is the social engagement layer that we launched in July. The idea here is that gamers are social. And the gaming is more fun when you're doing it with friends or in competition versus friends. And so Game Circle is an API that does allows customers to do a number of things. One is find friends, either through a Facebook link or through the Game Circle network directly. Second thing it does is allow customers to track their high scores, leaderboards, basically, in the cloud. These are developer-defined leaderboards, you know, as many as you'd like for a game, typically. Could also be for an app, but generally for a game. Third thing it does is allow for customers to track their achievements and compare their achievements to those of their friends. And the last part of Game Circle is that WhisperSync for games API that I talked about that allows for syncing of progress across devices. So that's kind of what it is. In terms of how we're presenting it, you can see we're starting to badge it and brand it a little bit. The key paradigm shift that we've made with Game Circle is elevation of games to really the primary content category on our new devices. So this is the main carousel, the homepage, if you will, of Kindle Fire HD. There's that shop tab that I mentioned before, which leads to that banner ad for Diner Dash. And then as you can see, the very next tab on the device is now games. That's different from our first device where you have to click on apps, and you go into the App Store, and you drill down into games. Games are so important to the usage on these devices that we now have it as a dedicated tab and the first one right after shop. When a customer clicks on games, they're taken to essentially a filtered view of all the apps they have installed on the device, which shows only the games. And for the games that have integrated with the Game Circle API, we surface these blue badges that provide kind of the Cliff Notes version of a customer's progress inside the game. So in this case, this particular person had four friends playing Cut the Rope HD. They had 4 out of 41 of the possible achievements in the game. They were at, I can't quite read that, as 88%, an 88 percentile from a high scores perspective. And the summary button takes you one level deeper. So the whole idea here is, without you being inside the game, you can keep tabs on what's happening in this game you're playing with your friends. If you see that your high score ranking is falling, or you're reminded that you're not as far as you wanted from an achievement standpoint, that should draw you back into the game. And that drives not only more frequent, but we find longer engagement with the games, which is very good for developers, very good for monetization, because the more touch points there are, the more chances there are for customers to get excited and potentially buy something. Clicking on the summary tab, you're taken into this view. You can see it's a little fuzzy, apologies for that, but you've got this person, so this is Emma. Here's her avatar icon, and then three of her friends. Down here is the first leaderboard showing how Emma's doing versus some of her friends, various percentiles. On the right-hand side, we have Emma's achievements in the game, and comparing that to her friend Andy. So just getting a little bit of the creative juices flowing here. The point I'd make about this from a UX design perspective, note that customers, they don't have to open an app to get into this experience. They don't have to create a Game Circle account to get into this experience, right? This is all native to the device. Again, it's pegged to the Amazon.com ID that we have resident on the device. It just works. And so the idea here is this, like the in-app purchasing conversion, is supposed to be totally friction-free and totally immersive. You go to the Games tab, this is how you basically evaluate your progress in games, and then you want to dive in. And then last thing here, starting to get a little bit into personalized discovery based on the Game Circle network. So in this case, Jason is a friend of Emma's, and Emma has said, gee, I wonder what Jason's playing, and a convenient way to discover additional apps that are already available on the device, and go right to the link in the store for him. So, a little bit of a summary there, and I think we talked about most of this. Super powerful technology, and we're seeing very rapid growth, not only in terms of the developers that have adopted it, but in consumers' use and engagement with the various features. And so that's some exciting news, and I think definitely one where if you're looking for a game developer, I would encourage you to take a look at it, as we'll talk about down the road here. Last thing I would point out about the devices is a new feature called Kindle Free Time. We just announced this one a couple of weeks back, and it's pretty great technology, I think. We noticed with the first Kindle Fire that the pass back use case, passing the device back to your kids in the backseat of the car, seemed to be very strong. We had lots of parents writing us and asking for more content that was appropriate for their children, and so decided that for the second round of devices, we were going to build an experience for parents and children from the ground up. And that experience is called Kindle Free Time. Basically, it is a playpen environment that parents can drop pieces of content that they've purchased into for their children to use. So you as a parent, you can set up a profile for each of your children, as many as you like, and then you decide which books, songs, videos, apps, and games are available for each of those profiles. The name, Free Time, comes from another feature which allows you to control the amount of time each child can spend using each media type each day. So you set up a profile for Johnny, and you say, okay, Johnny, he gets 30 minutes of game playing time a day. At that point, the games stop working when they're in the playpen. But you might say he can have as much time as he wants reading books, right? That never turns off. And so you can set different limits. And as you might expect, the playpen environment, which is this sort of blue experience here, has a whole bunch of protections for children. So the web browser doesn't work. You can't make purchases without entering your password. Location-based services are disabled. You know, the social features, Twitter, Facebook, etc., are all disabled, right? So the whole idea here is that you turn on Kindle Free Time, you hand it to your kid, you know, they're only going to see content that you've approved. They can only use it for as long as you'd like, and they're safe. So the reason I mention this is, from a developer's perspective, this is, we think, a super exciting opportunity if you happen to be developing content for kids. Because we know this is a prominent use case, and we think this is going to drive even more usage, more of that pass-back use case, more uses by children, and therefore kind of more discovery, more purchasing in that area. So we're pretty excited about it. Okay, a little bit of how we're driving engagement monetization. I'm going to talk now about what it takes to make a great app for Kindle Fire. First thing, obviously, is before you think about Kindle Fire, right, you just need to have great content. We see literally thousands of new apps each week. We're talking to hundreds of developers. And it seems like the apps that are successful cluster around one of these four central themes. Theme number one is, frankly, they do something better than any other app out there. Got Touchdown and Office Suite Pro up here. They're not revolutionary concepts. They're just fantastic apps for PIM management and for office-type document management. So one way to be super popular is just to work really well, like as simple as it sounds. Second one is to provide great value. That doesn't necessarily mean be free, although it can be. So Pandora, the obvious example, primarily free. There is Pandora 1 to get rid of the ads, but vast and amazing music experience available for free for most customers. Ocean House Media is a developer that has licensed the Dr. Seuss properties. They have interactive book apps for children. These are not free, but the value they provide in terms of the narration and the animation and the interactive features at, by the way, a much lower price point than your average children's book, the value was fantastic. And so that's another way to make a name for yourself, we found, is do something better for less than the benchmark. And the benchmark may not be another app. It may be the real-world experience that the customer is making the choice between. Being distinctive is another key one. This is sort of the more arts than science point, but it definitely is real. Whether you're developing the Om-Nom character or coming up with a new genre right around drawing, right, doodling, clearly the first app in a new space has a huge advantage, or I should say maybe the first app that does something well in a new space has a huge advantage. Doesn't mean you have to invent an entirely new business model. It might just be that you've done something in a distinctive way that customers fall in love with. And then the last point is that initial experience in the app or the game is really important. Apps and games that step customers into the play or the experience, either through a tutorial or through introductory levels, that cause the customer to fall in love with the content and the product and the storyline and make them want to continue, do really well. Because as a customer, you can't help yourself, right? By the time you figure out what you're doing, you want to continue on with the story. And so I've got Plants vs. Zombies here and Temple Run. You know, if you play each of those, it's really hard not to keep playing because by the time you know what to do, you're committed. We talked a little bit about business model. Definitely something worth spending a lot of time thinking about. As much as I talked about brand purchasing, that's not the only way to succeed. Developers that have brand recognition, apps, product families that have brand recognition, licensed intellectual property that has brand recognition, those are all still very much on target for the pay up front model. If on the other hand, you're trying to build awareness and or your product is progressive in some way, it has a story that's going to build on itself, going to allow you to unfold the content over time, has characters that reveal themselves over time. Those are the ones that we find are most appropriate for freemium. And so it's worth thinking about, you know, if you don't have the traits that make the app right for the pay up front model, but you also don't have these characteristics that make it right for the freemium model, it's probably time to sit down and think a little bit about what could be tweaked to make your architecture from a user experience perspective ideal for freemium. Because apps that are not this way and go with the freemium model don't always succeed. Subscriptions, I think, are very interesting. We offer subscriptions through the in-app purchasing API. I didn't talk much about it. Typically being used by developers and publishers that have used subscription in their other channels, like periodical app publishers. However, increasingly we're seeing game developers and other app companies start to experiment with the subscription model with a fair amount of success. It's tricky. You have to figure out how you're going to maintain the promise of a subscription. Typically, customers want more content delivered on a regular basis if you're going to go down that path. But for those that have figured it out, we're seeing that that churn is very low, and that it's a great way to get customers to fall in love with your brand and the promise it offers. The bottom point is basically one that says, no matter how you do it, having customers, finding a way for customers to become familiar with you, your content, without having to plunk down a lot of money first is always a good thing, whether it's a free trial for a subscription, whether it's baked inherently in a free play, freemium model, or whether it's just being great from a marketing, promotional standpoint for pay upfront titles. It's important because you just need some reason to get customers over the hump to buy, then they fall in love with you and your product, and good things tend to follow. Okay, down one level from that, still before we get to specifics about Fire, it's just really important to think carefully about what it takes to make a good tablet app versus a phone app. Particularly in the Android space, having great selection of tablets 7 inches and above is a relatively new phenomenon. And so we find, frankly, that a lot of developers are still thinking through what this means to go from stretching a phone app to something that's designed for 7 inches or 8.9 inches. Not rocket science, but the impact from a user experience perspective can be huge. First of all, thinking through, baking in a new layout for the larger screen size, we think is really critical. You maybe can just get by at 7 inches by taking your phone app and redoing some of the touch targets and making sure that everything is, is high res enough to look good on the device. Once you go beyond 7 inches, you really need to have a tablet-specific layout, we found. It just doesn't look right if you stretch. And so what does that mean? We've got Evernote here as a good example of that, I think. So on the left-hand side, this was their phone app, which incidentally, from a resolution standpoint, looked great. It was totally usable, right? There wasn't a lot of pixelation. You could actually see all the targets. Everything was fine. But there's a ton of white space in there, obviously, and it's just not very attractive. So what they did was a couple things. First of all, they split the device in half, and they went from just having navigation at the top level of the app to having actually the user's content in these sliding horizontal panes and having navigation. So they basically brought up the entire part of the user experience of the app to that top level and removed the click for customers, which is always good. Then they took their top two customer use cases, the user stories of creating a new note and taking a picture and really turning that into a note, made those very common, and also found that on tablets, they were seeing much heavier use of audio notes and also attachments. And so they elevated those to, again, that sort of primary user story experience paradigm at the top. And then they listed the other paradigms right down below that. Also, they took the actions that were part of the settings menu during the soft keys, and they pulled them out. And they now have those never-present, basically secondary sub-nav bar at the top, where customers, again, can get to that without going one click deep into the app. And so if you look at it, what they've done is they've collapsed the app in two ways. They've basically pulled content and settings information all up to the top of the screen, and I think made it more, you know, more visually pleasing at the same time. So these are not huge coding changes, but they're dramatic from a layout perspective and have, you know, basically a revolutionary impact on what it's like to use this app as a customer. So definitely worth thinking about these types of things when you're moving, I think, even to 7-inch and certainly beyond 7-inch to 8.9. Kindle Fire should be easy. So once you have content that you're happy with and you have an app that's designed for a tablet, you don't have too far to go to make a really great app on Kindle Fire. Some developers find they have nothing to do. Others have a little more. It depends a little bit on the app or the game and what's baked into it. First, obviously, you have to make sure that you're taking advantage of the hardware and software that's there, not trying to use hardware and software that's not. That's not often as complicated as it seems. We have a number of apps that have baked in use, let's say, for the camera, for the Kindle Fire first generation. You know, rather than having to rip it out, you just kind of basically say, hey, this feature's not supported on this device. That's fine, right? It works really well. But those considerations are important in making sure the experience looks clean. Biggest gotchas that we see are, number one, not having high-definition assets. When you get to even a 7-inch high-def screen, if you don't have dedicated libraries, dedicated assets, it's going to look pixelated. Things are going to be off. So it's worth, you know, kind of taking that step and making sure that you're loading the right libraries up there. This is a big one, actually. So tablets, it's not so obvious which way customers are going to own tablets. Which way customers are going to hold a tablet from an orientation perspective. We often find that sometimes developers take some shortcuts, make some assumptions around which way a device is going to be held, and that results in some funny experiences. And so we definitely encourage developers to go through the pain of reading the sensors to make sure that orientation is great right from the beginning. We do have soft key bars at the bottom. It's important to avoid the conflicts with the soft key bars. Not that different from the Nexus that's out there, but something to think about. Fluidity and performance are important. So as developers add in the high definition assets, refactor for to take greater advantage of the real estate, we're finding that the payload, the packages are getting much bigger. And that means that the load time, particularly on start or transitions between levels, are getting longer and longer. It's really important, we found, to think about that and find a way to keep the customers engaged and entertained during those pauses. You'd be surprised, but we see customers giving negative reviews to apps when they feel like the load time is too long or the transitions are too long, when a simple splash screen, a little bit of a graphic, is all it takes for them to feel like something is happening. So small nuance as we move into bigger packages, but actually super important from a user experience perspective. International localization is another important one. Could be as simple as adding language packs for the various countries that you're going to make your app available in. Could be more complex. We found that a number of game developers, rather than go down the localization path, have actually pulled language out of their apps and found that they could basically do, they could communicate what they needed to communicate with iconography rather than words, which simplified localization activity. Another thing that some developers are doing is really looking at what the top-selling apps and games are like in a particular market, looking at the information density, for example, that consumers in a market segment ought to expect, and actually adapting to fit a little bit more of consumers' expectations. It's pretty amazing. If you look at the best-selling apps and games in different countries, presentation tends to be pretty different. And so this is, again, we're on the early stages here, but if you want to make your app feel localized, that's something to take a look at as well. Here's an example. This is a Need for Speed early version running on an 8.9-inch tablet. And just would point out a couple of things. You know, it's another one that I think they've done a great job of optimizing it. Gigantic touch targets, but it's appropriate for a large screen, right? You don't want to have a little teeny touch target when you're holding this beautiful device. And similarly, all of the features, whether it's the time, the position, kind of speed bars, everything is totally optimized for the device. And I also put this one up here to show that, you know, very high performance games run fantastically on these devices, even when we're thinking a lot about price point in terms of the chipset that's inside. This is a big game, I think it's about 600 megs, and you know, when the device comes out, you'll see that it plays really well. Last thing that I would point out is that we have this suite of services starting with AWS. We talked about in-app purchasing, we talked about Game Circle. We also have an Amazon Maps SDK that we launched recently. One thing to note about the device is they do not have the Google Mobile Suite of applications on them. So when it comes to IAP or mapping, it's not just recommended, you actually need to use the services we provide because the hooks for Google are just not there. And so again, we think you'll be happy with the results, as hopefully you agree, seeing some of the data here for IAP in particular. But that is an important step for Amazon devices. A couple examples, I think I'm just going to skip over in just a time. All right, so last section, fairly quick. Just wanted to highlight some of the resources we have and talk about how to get started. Hopefully, you're all familiar with Amazon Web Services. We have SDKs for iOS and for Android that make it really simple to integrate with our foundational services in the mobile context. So if you haven't checked out the Mobile Developer Center there, I would encourage you to do that. The rest of the action occurs in the mobile app distribution portal. Developer.amazon.com, you go to the mobile app distribution portal. This is where we have not only where you can set up your accounts and upload all of your apps and games, but where we have all of the basically supporting information. Click on the SDK tab. You will see SDKs for all of the services that we've talked about here. Behind each of those is basically a category page where we have everything that you would expect. We have detailed documentation, we have quick start guides, we have best practices, we have some videos, we have emulators now for each of the Amazon tablets. So even if you don't have any devices, you can basically develop your app and know that it's going to work based on some of those considerations we're talking about. So the documentation is pretty robust at this point. Sample code, obviously, I think I've talked about all that. Here's a screenshot of the 8.9-inch emulator running from one of our own games from Reflexive down in Orange County. We've got a whole bunch of FAQs out there. We've been doing this for a while and have a pretty good idea of the questions people are going to have. And so we're hoping you can find most of your answers there. If that doesn't work, we now have developer forums out there. They're pretty active, so developers helping other developers. We also have, I didn't take a screenshot, but we have a contact us link Again, I have a team of real human beings that read every customer, every contact us that comes in. So if you don't find what you're looking for in the documentation, or developers can't help, just send us a note and someone will get back to you with the answer. And that is it. So we've got developer@amazon.com. A couple places to follow us, and you're always welcome feedback. So I think at this point, hopefully that was a useful overview, and happy to take whatever questions y'all might have. Yes. Yes.
All right. So I have a mic, and let's see. Try to scoot in.
Hey, I just had a question about premium games on the Amazon App Store. So we have a game out on the Android App Store and it's doing pretty well. We're partnered with Tapjoy. We make a decent amount of money through the advertising and incentivized installs, and I was wondering if those sort of things are available on the Amazon App Store as well.
Yeah, good question, sure. Yes, they are. I guess what I would say is we, on the one hand, recognize that those technologies are another powerful tool for monetization for developers, particularly in the freemium space. And so see a ton of value in them for that reason. I think I would say that I personally am cautious about any activity that would go so far as to undermine consumers' confidence in core navigational features of our store. So if, for example, customers were to come to believe that our bestseller lists were actually just kind of advertisements, right? Or heaven forbid that customer reviews were not actual customer sentiment, right? But were just, again, advertisements, that would be bad for everybody, not just for our store, but potentially for even all of Amazon. There's a spectrum in here, and we actually haven't put out a formal policy that says, here's where we're drawing the line. I guess that's just what I would encourage you and anybody else that's thinking about this technology to be cognizant of, is that we want to drive monetization, but also make sure that the marketplace is trusted by consumers. Does that make sense? Okay. There was one up there. Yes?
Could you comment a little about the distribution agreement, particularly with respect to what appears to be the developer ceding control of price to Amazon? It looks like with the paid apps that we get either 70% of the gross take, or with a floor of 20% of the list.
Good question. Thank you. That actually was our original position, and it's changed. So we changed it a number of months ago. A couple things. First of all, we are different than the other stores, and that we are a first-party store, which means Amazon is actually the seller of these products to consumers. And so, as a developer, you supply the list price, and then we, as the seller, we actually set the sales price that the consumer pays. What's different is that no matter what the sales price we set, you always get 70% of the list price. That's the change we made. So whether it's paid up front app or an in-app purchase item, you know what you're getting. We have preserved the right to use some of the marketing and merchandising levers that that we think we know how to use, some of which involve discounts. What I would offer is, if you look at the store today, the vast, vast majority of products are just selling at list price. And going back to that targeted marketing and merchandising that I was showing before, the way we like to do things when we're thinking about discounts is we're working with developers so that we not only have a discount, but we have lots of resonant marketing, not only on our properties, but hopefully on the developer properties as well, to make a bunch of noise and drive excitement if we're going to be doing a promotion. Does that answer your question?
Well, sure.
Okay.
We have a product that's set real high price, very narrow market.
Yeah.
And my concern is that you guys discount the hell out of it for a couple of days, and my market just everybody that's going to buy it buys it in 2 days at $1.99 for a $14 product.
Yeah.
And I'm screwed. I guess it sounds like, you know, if I get 70% of my 14, then life's okay, you know, but we're kind of discounting.
Yeah. So what I would say is, one, you're right. You would always get 70% of the $14.99. What I would say is, clearly if we were doing stuff like that all the time, we have lots of really mad developers and, you know, not a smart strategy for trying to build trust among our developer community. So we are a first-party store, right? So we do have the contractual right. We thought a long time about whether we thought that was the right model and thought it was, but I'd say that if you talk to developers in the store, I think you'd find that concern you're talking about is probably not something you need to worry about a whole lot.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you.
Yeah.
Good, I'm back here. Yeah. Thanks a lot for coming out of Portland and talking about the Amazon App Store.
Sure.
I just want to congratulate you and your team on taking greater responsibility for user experience in mobile. We need more work like this, so good job.
Great.
I had a question specifically focused on the subscription stuff.
Okay.
You had kind of alluded to a burgeoning opportunity in subscriptions. And I was curious, first, if you have any either data or anecdotal evidence about what you're seeing there, so you can maybe explain a little bit more about what you're seeing in subscriptions. Mm-hmm. And also how Amazon, if there's any restrictions on linking out, for example, to subscriptions being done directly by the developer, or any kind of restrictions around that kind of thing.
Good question. So when it comes to the data, one, subscriptions outside of, verticals have typically been based on subscriptions like periodicals. It's small, but the data is just growing very rapidly. And we actually see a pretty wide range of activity. Some of the developers have decided that they're going to deliver new content on a regular cadence. So the subscription is, for example, it's $2.99 a month, and each month we're going to deliver 10 new levels in this game. And so basically the subscription is for that ongoing promise of new content. Others have decided that they're going to basically deliver variants of the product inside, so maybe it's a new world inside of the game. I suppose you can consider that a level, but it's not a new app, it's not a new game, but it's basically a new chapter, maybe is a way to describe it, of the experience. Still others have gone with basically the premium levels of service model, where you can play the game without subscribing at all, but you're limited in terms of what areas you can access, what things you can do. And they have a couple different subscription tiers that customers can graduate into if they want to enhance their experience. These are just a few off the top of my head, I think, through the folks that have adopted it. So it's a wide variety, and frankly, I think they're all doing fairly well. I don't know that there's a clear winning path emerging yet, other than it's great. I think the consumers are interested in that. When it comes to linking out, this is an area where, particularly on the Amazon devices, we want to have a really pristine experience when it comes to purchasing. The ask is, if the app is going to be offering content that can be consumed inside of the app, we do want developers to use our in-app purchasing technology. Couple reasons. One is, it works well, and the developers will be pleased with it. But also from a consumer's perspective, we want the devices in particular to have a really consistent purchase experience. While this is relatively new for our customers, we want them to see the Amazon brand, know that our trusted payments infrastructure is behind it, know that the promise of our customer service team is behind it. I think it's really important to getting customers to trust in the devices, and to open their wallets for some of these new and emerging business models. So who knows what the future may bring. We may decide that we don't need this down the road, but for now, we're asking for, purchases of digital content that can be consumed inside the apps to go through our IFPG SDK. Yep.
Hi, is there a mechanism for anything like coupon codes, developers being able to give away, complimentary purchase anything like that where it's targeted towards the app that they created, not just money on the store.
So you're saying from inside your app, you would want to give away maybe a physical good or give away another app? Or
no, maybe from a booth at an expo or just for developers to give to friends and family, you know.
I'm with you. No, we don't have that yet. We've actually had a request a couple of times. Basically, I want 1,000 friends and family codes that I can give out and give it. No, we don't have it yet. It's a good idea, but we don't have that today. Yeah.
There's one over here.
Over here? Okay.
Hi, I had a follow-up question about in-app purchasing. We've been talking to developer support about batch uploading and support for large in-app content libraries. We're on the order of 2,000 in-app content pieces, and my understanding is there is only individual in-app purchase item manipulation and no batch uploading, and not currently any plans.
That's unless you know the secret handshake.
Okay, I need to learn the secret handshake.
We do have some capabilities. Why don't we talk afterwards?
All right, thanks.
We have, for example, Comixology uses our technology, and they've got a huge number of SKUs. So let's talk. Yeah.
Secret handshake is awesome. Yeah. We could just do a class session right now if you want.
Right, yeah.
Is there anyone on that side, Matt?
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
There doesn't seem to currently be in the App Store a way to refund customers if they're unhappy, and that seems to be a common way to deal with people who just weren't happy with content in the app, unless they go through Amazon themselves. I noticed in response to that, a common mechanism is for developers to give out Amazon gift cards. Is there one plans for being able to do returns yourself as a developer to respond to complaints? And two, is there anything bad about doing the gift card mechanism?
So it's another good question. So by design now, we are trying to funnel all basically customer service back through Amazon customer service. Feel like we have a good reputation for customer service. We want customers to know that the same service they've experienced, whether they're buying any physical product or digital product, right, they're going to have that no matter what they're buying. So for that reason, we want all the service inquiries to be routed through us. I would say nothing wrong with doing the gift card things other than, from a messaging standpoint, don't want customers to be confused. Right, about where they go if they do have a problem. If you've ever called in as a customer, right, what you would expect is we take care of you. That's our current thing. Yeah.
What are your thoughts on mobile device management, mobile enterprise management?
Thank you.
Bring your own device to work and enterprise apps in general.
So actually, that's a great question. We just announced, we announced a feature, not through the App Store, but it was part of a book's press release, about a feature called WhisperCast, where we're basically building the capability for enterprises to mass and title content for a class of devices, basically. Group of devices, a managed pool of devices, is the right way to say it. As a footnote in that release, we announced that the feature is coming for apps as well. I don't think we announced a specific timeline, but it's pretty soon. Hopefully that's the kind of thing you're talking about. Basically, the functionality for books, you've got Salesforce, and you're going to give out 1,000 of the fire HDs, and you want to give everybody right these 10 books to read, and those just automatically appear right in the libraries of the Salesforce that have the services. And so we're bringing that same capability to apps, although it's not live today. It's a segment that we're thinking about a lot because we're getting inquiries from a number of businesses that say, price point's pretty attractive. What features do you have for us? And this is the first one that's coming out.
Just two more questions. So over here, and then there's another person, or I'll take the password.
Yeah. All right, right here. So we do quite a bit of development with location-based apps, and one of the things you talked about was that if we move over to using Amazon's platform, we do need to move over to using your Maps API. And as we saw with Apple coming out with their own map system, for us as developers, it was a little bit chaotic. Can you talk a little bit about what your Maps API offers, and maybe in comparison and contrast to Google?
Yep. And I would separate LBS from the mapping technology. I'm not sure which you mean. So for the new devices, we have LBS through either the Wi-Fi chip or GPS in the 8.9 inch device. And so if what you need is simply location, you can get that from the platform without having to integrate with our map system. When it comes to actually rendering maps, you do have a couple of options. So we've partnered we have Amazon Maps in partnership with Nokia and their mapping technology. And so it's pretty simple. It works, I don't know how much if you look at it versus Google Maps, it works in very much the same way. And so that's one option. There is another option, there are many other options, whether you want to kind of use framed web versions, but the one thing we don't have is the hooks for Google Maps. And so this one is not a hard requirement to use our Maps SDK. We're just trying to fill a hole that we know exists because we don't have the hooks for Google Maps. Okay.
Hi. One question about the approval process compared to the other stores, for example. They're kind of polar opposites. So what is the approval process, and also what is developer relation there in terms of issues or problems you come up with? How quickly can the app be updated, changed, things like that to resolve problems?
Good question. So we do have an approval process. I think we're in the middle, is what most developers tell us, between the between Google and Apple, other platforms. We test every app primarily to make sure that that it's going to work for the vast majority of our installed base, not only our own devices, but also the phones and tablets, non-Amazon phones and tablets that we know make up the vast majority of our installed base around the world. Our goal is not to be prescriptive about what constitutes good app design. We're not trying to enforce any sort of design paradigm, consistency standards. You're the expert in your app. We just want to make sure that customers have a good experience. And so we test for that. We also do have content guidelines. We allow a pretty wide range of stuff in the store, but there is some material that we just think our customers don't want to see. And so I think that chances are you won't have to worry about that, but I know that that is out there as well. Typically, apps go through the process in a couple of days. And if we have a problem, then we message the developer. If it's a simple thing, you typically get an email that says, hey, we found this problem that's crashing on the Gimlefire HD7 inch, you should take a look at it. Here's what we saw, right, in the stack trace, kind of go take a look. If it's more involved, oftentimes we'll just reach out and try and either have an email dialogue or get on the phone and figure out what's going on. So we're pretty hands-on. When it comes to upgrades, they tend to be even faster. We still do test them. This is sort of a learning by experience. We've had some pretty catastrophic upgrade failures on apps that have always worked perfectly, and for whatever reason, version 11, doesn't. That's a problem when you have hundreds of thousands or millions of users that are going to automatically get an update. So we do still test them, but it tends to be even faster than the initial submission. Yeah.
All right. Again, thank you very much, Aaron, for coming down and putting on the great presentation. Thank you.
Good.
I think we'll. There's still an opportunity. I think we are for a little bit of people have questions. Is this mic actually on?
No.
It doesn't appear to be.
We can hear you though.
All right. So a couple things. Again, thank you to Aaron, thank you to Garrett and Ziva for hosting us. Thank you to Steve and to Carrie and all the people from Metro Mile for providing the food. We will have our next formal meeting in January. We don't have a formal meeting in December. We are entertaining the idea of doing a holiday party. So if you're interested in something like that, let us know. Otherwise, we will see you the fourth Monday in January. Thank you all for coming out.